an unsurpassed friend? No?
No.
No. They?
They.
Individuals in the event that we drop below the amount of number of two for the purpose likelihood is quite remote in that sense. We have currently three independent members. The requirement is that we each have a minimum of two. But as I say, we also have a number of other independent members appointed to a panel to fall back on in the event that we require one. For the purposes of ensuring that we have at least the minimum of two independent persons required for the panel.
Thank you, Chair. I've got the process. But how are we doing this in the sense that these people we have to find? There must be a mysterious grapevine when we start moving around and say we need somebody. How often does that happen? If you need somebody, who can we let the child actually know?
In the event that we do have an issue with the last numbers, then the recommendation is that the relevant chief officer, because clearly, if it's myself, for example, then I would be conflicted, in which case I'll probably have the head of page service or the section officer, or the strategic director could effectively make those invite another independent person in consultation with the chair of the Employment and Employment Committee. So they could discuss and find who they consider to be suitable. It may be two or three people that we would have to invite or at least approach to see whether they are free or available to assist in relation to this matter. And then the recommendation is such that the chairperson of the Employment and Employment Committee would have the delegated power to then make that formal appointment of that individuals to the panel in order to ensure that we are constitutional for the purposes of the regulations. So it will be very much in consultation of the chair, but there would have to be some fluidity around who we approach, purely because it would also be dependent upon availability and so on and so forth. So it's intended to be flexible for that purpose in order to ensure that there's no one due to them.
Okay.
Two things, Chair. One is, would they be fully trained by to be appointed? Because you say we're going to go around, they might be trained on another thing, but not on the disability. And the other thing is there a timeline between the start and of the process and the end of it?
The regulations don't specifically require anyone in respect, the whole idea is to have independent views being part of the steering of the process. So rather than having an independent designated person effectively undertaking the investigation, etc., the idea is you probably still would have taken the investigation into any allegations of disciplinary nature, which could potentially give rise to a dismissal recommendation. But you would seek the views of the independent person as part of this panel, who would then make recommendations or express their views to council, because it is council that must now make that final decision. But the independent persons don't require any specific training, and to some extent, the idea of the independent person is to bring that independent perspective. So therefore, it's not necessarily geared around training, although clearly an understanding of the way in which the mechanics of the council work, and that many of our independent persons will get a certain amount of training around how the council functions and how we deal with issues. And that hopefully will provide sufficient ground and framework for them to be able to undertake this role.
Councillor? Yeah, just one second. I might have missed this statistic. But does the person who's been judged upon have the right to reject somebody if the person has been in the statistic? Or is it imposed upon them?
No, they wouldn't have any rights to challenge that, unless, of course, there is a conflict of interest issue arising, which they would have to make known sooner rather than later. If somebody's going to suggest that an independent person is not independent for whatever reason, they will need to be very clear as to what the basis is for that. And subject to what has been suggested, we would need to consider that carefully.
And who would consider that?
Again, it will be dependent upon if it didn't involve the head of page service, then arguably the head of page service could look into that, and the strategic director could effectively undertake that role to ensure, if it was a complaint for myself, for example, that there was an issue with regards to an independent member, then I would expect either my own strategic director to look at that, or indeed the head of page service to consider that issue to ensure that that matter was resolved in one shape or form.
We have had a case in the past that employees being victimized at
You have to remember that any allegation that is made will be subject to an investigation. I would expect there to be an independent investigation into the allegations that are undertaken, because we are dealing with the head of paid service, the chief financial officer, and the monitoring officer.
What do you mean by an independent
investigation? Somebody who's independent of the potential public counsel, given the nature of, if you are looking at, because this is essentially around dismissal, so you are looking at something quite significant. So the nature of the issue would probably warrant an approach of that kind in order for there to be proper due process demonstrated. And therefore, on that basis, any independent person appointed would be known to, or details of that person will be shared with the individual in question. And so if there was any conflict of interest arising, it would be picked out at that point, before you also embarked on the investigation itself.
What we've got here is a document of the new process and how we actually get to the new process. I think we're straying into realms of cases and what happens if somebody is this, that, or the other. Well, I think that needs to be tested at the time and give them cases to be on board with that, of that nature. I think what we have to do is trust in the legislation and allow us to. An independent person don't need an independent debate being to themselves to be. And, you know, I mean, that's the case, you're going to get into grey areas. I think the system has to be tested. And that's what we're looking to do. The first time it's tested, it would be, see whether the legislation is good or bad. At the moment, everything's hypothetical in this document. And so there's actually something tested. And it may not be here, maybe elsewhere in the country. The standardised legislation now is how we're going forward. So I think getting into semantics is sometimes be a dangerous way, based on some verse, or is clear legislation. So it's tested, it's untried.
Any councillor? Any more comments? Recommend to take to council, all agree?
Agree.
Thank you.
Chair.
Is the next item
the
summary of standards and events? I wonder whether I can have the advice of Sarah on this. I did declare an interest. However, I'm conscious that I have made a complaint. It doesn't appear to be one of those assistants that I've made a complaint against another. Do I need to declare an interest in this? I'm not sure.
No, I don't believe you do. The whole idea of the summary report is for you to look at how complaints generally are being managed as opposed to specific issues. As you know, we do encourage and ensure, or try to ensure, that details of complaints are not shared openly, particularly with deadline matters, in order to ensure that they can be properly examined and considered. But you are perfectly, I don't see there's any conflict with regards to you expressing views about how matters are being managed in order to improve the way in which the complaint process is working. And in fact, there is something to be said about individuals who, if they have had any dealings with the process, can offer ways of improving themselves at all.
What else is wrong with this report? What else can be trusted? I'll continue.
continue with this one, because it says, receive 30th of November 2014. There's nothing within the initial evaluation. 8 months down the line, and Mr. Bloss, who is supposed to carry out this initial investigation, has not done it. 8 months down the line. In the previous standards committee that I served on, I'm sure you're aware, Mr. Chair, we raised repeatedly why complaints were taken 2, 3, in some cases 4 years to complete. And we put to practice a series of protocols which stated timeframes for these things to be dealt with. Tell you from out the window, 8 months of initial investigation that hasn't even taken place yet. I think we allowed it for 6 weeks. 8 months. I don't see how these complaints can be allowed to stand. I mean, Mr. Bloss should tell the complaints and the person to weigh in that, that because of his incompetence or inability to carry this out, this complaint is now there.
No, I don't understand that.
It's
another issue I wanted to talk about.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Mine is around the timeline, that's why I asked you before. Again, we've got a time, you know, we did lay the timeline down. I was here, part of the process, and now we're expanding on it. And that's what my concern is, that on the previous one, that is there a timeline that we can work to? Just to show fairness.
This is a disgrace. This is a disgrace to this council. Councillors here, and the council and its officers should be ashamed of themselves.
I agreed the timeline, and agreed, and I'm going to say as the chair, but the standard's not good enough, and that's not good enough. And we did agree the timeline, don't
we?
Future. I hear the comments and I'm holding those back and obviously discuss those with just necessarily automatically due to inaction, as it were. But I accept that doesn't mean there can't be room for improvement. I accept that point. In terms of the outcome, one of the things that we do have, of the 11 complaints that we have had, that were two us still ongoing as a live matter. But on page 2.5, I'll set out, just to give you an overview in terms of what the outcomes have effectively been on those 11, and 6 effectively have been upheld. 3 have been partially upheld because we've been able to take advantage of the local resolution, finding an alternative way of resolving an issue, a legitimate issue that's come about without necessarily subjecting it to an informal process of complaint, which doesn't necessarily achieve the desired outcome. And one of the reasons why we introduced the protocol and introduced this local resolution and the opportunity to find a more informal way of the counselling question and complaint resolving their differences or issues was to enable them the opportunity to explore that as an alternative to a formal investigation and a formal process being adopted. And on 3 occasions we've achieved that. And I think that's a positive outcome in the sense that we have ended up with complainant and the subject counsellor arriving at an agreed position, which is proportionate and appropriate because I will undertake an initial evaluation and assessment. And if the matter is so significant, then clearly it doesn't lend itself to local resolution, then clearly I'll refer the matter for investigation because the seriousness, the aggravating factors require that. So we have moved forward in terms of the approach and the effectiveness of ensuring that we have a formal process which is sufficiently robust. I take the point about making sure it's timely. But we've also got an informal arrangement which does lend itself from time to time to a more effective resolution, particularly if you look at it from a complainant's perspective, to achieve an outcome to what they were looking for, because they're saying they complained for. So there's a balance to be struck between that and the issues in question. As I say, we have 2 live masks which make up the effective level. So whilst there are issues around lack of respect, we have to recognise also 6 of those 11 cases, that was actually held as a legitimate complaint. Doesn't necessarily mean we can't or shouldn't look at why the complaint was raised in the first instance and take some learning from that to avoid the complaint coming in the first place. But if one looks at it against the yardstick of a code, 6 of over half, less than half, so more than half have
effectively. Just take that point, however, when you achieve the local resolution and then that person may go on again and fail to treat people with that person with respect, that indicates that that achieved resolution actually didn't really resolve anything because they learned nothing from it. I'm making the point, and I don't want, you know, I don't think you can answer it really. It's to me, a little bit too specific.
But I would just take that into account in determining if I was dealing with the same counsellor and I'm dealing with essentially the same issue, the fact that they haven't learned arguably from the last occasion would be a factor to take into account as to whether this matter should then actually be referred for formal investigation rather than local resolution.
Yeah, I just think this is an ideal opportunity, given that the next item is now what's the range of sanctions available to the local authority through the legislation? And actually doing that is a way to bring back a clear understanding on what happens in the due process. And probably we haven't got that clear understanding, and I'm not sure whether there is actually one out there. You know, and we probably might need to ask other people what they do in a similar situation. It might be because the legislation has been changed, and it's now new that there isn't anything there in place. Do we want to put something there, or do we not want to put something there? I think that's the ideal opportunity with officers to go away and get that record on, and look at that as a whole piece of work and bring back a clear resolution this committee can actually endorse and go forward with.
Chair, it isn't at all easy to hear up this end. First of all, we have people not putting the microphone on, and we have people putting the microphone on and turning away when they're speaking. Could I ask them? For the purposes of this end of the table, at least people make sure that they can be heard. Thank you.
Chair, just going back about 3 years now when the legislation changed, we did have a working group that looked at what could be done. That working group also set out timescales and protocols for dealing with complaints in order to try and get them reduced back from 2 years to a reasonable time. And effectively, if I'm dragging this from the back of memory now, effectively, the standards complaints now can be referred for investigation. You can be found guilty of whatever the offence is. But if it's not something criminal, then the council is toothless. It doesn't have sanctions. It can recommend things like counselling. It can recommend things like a written apology. But if that member decides that he's going to do anything about it, there's nothing that this committee or this council can do to that member. So it's pointless setting them another working group to go through the same process. The legislation only allows the standards complaints that are serious enough to be dealt with as a criminal matter by the police. There is no standing complaint that can be, that a sanction can be applied and enforced by this council. And perhaps we want to know some of these terms.
If I can clarify the point you're making, if I may, it is correct that the Localism Act provided a solution to what was the rather arcane and rather rigid framework that we previously had, whereby everything had to be investigated or was subject to a rather difficult framework which was not very workable. So the Localism Act basically said you had to have a code of conduct and you had to put in place essentially arrangements for how complaints are dealt with, how you deal with complaints, and sanctions thereafter as appropriate. What it also did was remove power of a local authority to suspend a council. And that does now vest with the magistrates' court. And it is the Director of Public Prosecution that will bring any matter where potential prosecution or indeed suspension could arise, and therefore, unless, as you would expect, something is done which is of significance, it's highly likely on the thought that the DPP is going to bring the prosecution for some of the more less significant matters that we have had to experience and deal with as part of our complaints against members. So, the sanction on suspension is very much now outside the beams of any local authority. It does not mean that you don't have, this council doesn't have the power to impose sanctions, or as maybe has indicated, you do have apologies, verbal apologies, and various other sanctions or actions we could impose. They are, depending on how you should view it, whether you feel that they are effective or not. They are limited in terms of how much scope training is another option that you could do and look at. And we every year ask the working group to revisit both the code and the protocol to see how it can be made more effective, as well as look at the duty to promote high standards. So in terms of the position, it is weaker as a result, I accept. But the real issue, I think, what the Localism Act tried to actually get across is empowering local authorities themselves and members to design and devise how they wish to deal with the issue of member behaviour, in the hope that essentially members lead that particular issue themselves.
And am I correct in when I remember, I think, that the party leaders signed up to a protocol to use their influence as leaders of their group on people who were not behaving in a manner that was disappointed. Am I correct in that?
Yes, there was one provision which we changed last year, but essentially the relevant group leader is notified of any standards complaints made against every member. And that was again to design the rationale behind that was the group leader could then look at whether there's patterns of behaviour, any particular issues they felt was appropriate that as a group leader they needed to address with either that particular individual or individuals. And again, that was geared around trying to promote better behaviour. High standards of conduct within groups, and that was the rationale behind it. So yes, in essence, that was
important. Yeah, just to confirm again, perhaps I'm also confirm, when the Localism Act came into effect, there was a discussion as to whether we even had to have standards committee. The council does not have to have a standards committee. Would you confirm that also?
Yes, absolutely. That's perfectly within this council's gift as to the have a standards committee. That question was posed, and given the issues around standards at the time, members felt that it was appropriate that there be a standards committee, and obviously the agreement was extended to include constitutional oversight as well as funding committees. So, and again, every year the whole purpose of the working group members to essentially take control of this agenda, design the protocol, look at higher standards. We do have a duty, the council does have a duty to promote higher standards. And the working group is there to help encourage and look at how we can do that. And that has to be done with everyone's voice across part of the group.
Unfortunately, I've never actually been in a position where the council have got to advise this for a group leader to take. I thought I had a lot of people to actually. So I assume it depends on the experience and goodwill or ability of any group leader or any party anywhere. If you're the one that puts the person against the wall and says, you've really done it this time, comrade or mate or friend, and we're not putting up with it any longer and see what happens. But I suppose it's a bit like Sir Geoffrey Howard. Don't you see me saying something like Sir Geoffrey being attacked by Geoffrey Howard like being savaged by a dead sheep? Or where's that effect? And it is a bit like that, I'm afraid. So I am interested, I am wondering if we could perhaps ask officers to deal with the query the council lately raised about different versions of the report, so we can have some information on how a different report came to be published and why it was revised and what happened in that process. Purely for transparency, whatever, to know what did happen, rather than trying to thrash it out here when we haven't got the versions before us and we're listening and understanding what Councillor Blakely said, but we'd rather have some writing at some point. Thank you.
Thank you.
Councillor Gilder has set the catalogue of the pity. Now we all ponder which one of the three would be the dead sheep.
However, dealing with that particular complaint that has been made, as referred to. In terms of details, any confidential information being shared or disclosed, none of that has happened because, as you know, the report itself is anonymized for that specific purpose, so it's not a data report. That was never on my part as a strategic director, but he was dealing with that particular information advisor on there. Are you still saying you wish to have to attend the next meeting?
Yes.
In relation to item number
11? Well, in relation, no, I'm not saying it's in relation to item 11.
Certainly correctly, we ordered this management committee on the past performance transformation results.
And the second thing I've lost track of over the years is there is a complaint, a series of levels of complaints when a citizen is dissatisfied with the council and a response. Sometimes we see emails for citizens going through various stages. And there seem to be social services stages, there seem to be other departments. And I'm wondering where that gets reported to, how we have an overall picture of what is a complaint, how is the council dealt with it, whether the citizen has that satisfaction. Is that through the new directorates, or is that something relevant to our work?
We capture corporate legal complaints that are made in relation to council issues and council matters. Our own council procedure has three stages to it, and then the individual is entitled to go to the local government office, but if they're still dissatisfied with any response. And so we are able to extrapolate those complaints to be dealt with at stage one, which is being formal, and then gradually it's more formal on the way to the LGO. And we're able to actually extrapolate that from the CRM system in terms of the level of stages that cases have been dealt with. I'll need to come back to you as to whether or not we actually have further information as to whether it's been satisfactory. One would like to think that if matters have been concluded at the informal stage, then it's likely, more likely than not, that a satisfactory resolution has been achieved, but that it may not necessarily always be the case for every single case, but I'll have to make some inquiries as to whether we have further information about the outcomes and how we record outcomes, if we do at all, other than just the way in which matters are dealt with and timescales are going to be.
Okay, anybody else?
It went through the process, went to Stanley Spring, was dismissed with no case transfer, went through it again, was dismissed again. And at what point, the question that I'm asking is, what point does that become a vexatious complaint? That's my question at that point. Yes. Somebody has used the same process three times to achieve the same outcome. Is there a case then to be bringing a vexatious complaint? And what I'm saying is, once a process has been used several times by an individual and achieved the same outcome, which in my case was no case to answer, at that point was I able to bring a case for vexatious complaints? I didn't pursue it, but I think the answer is probably I was able to.
Okay, do we approve the working party then? Carries on this way. Do you want to submit the names? Wait on me, or do you want to submit on that?
Well, it'll be one of the things. No, it won't be any. I'm not just in the Labour Party, but clearly a few people are now substitute for those members.
Yeah.
I'm happy to sit on the Labour Party for our group and any other time, maybe besides Jerry or John.
Two.
Yes, me and you. Okay, me and John Hale are the journeys of deputy.
Right. Okay. And Phil, you sit on for me.
I was going to say the name, because I can nominate you as well as the deputy.
Well, the deputy's around. Deputy's the standard, yeah. Yeah. And then, Johnny.
I'm ready for party.
Independent members can be on the right group, only all one.
Leave it as it is, Chair.
I can't hear you.
Leave it as it is.
Right, okay, yeah. Okay. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Okay. Agreed. Okay. Agreed. Okay. Agreed. Okay. Agreed. Thank you for the attendance.